My name is Vinita Puri and I am the professor and head of the Department of Plastic Surgery at St. J.S. Medical College. So actually, I am a by mistake doctor, if that's what I'd like to say. But I think once I became a doctor, after that, I have just loved doing what I do. So all throughout, I think while I was in school, it was understood that I was going to do engineering. But during the time when we got into engineering or medicine, we did not have these kind of entrance exams. We had separate entrance exams for each place. So I had got very good marks in my PCB as well as PCM. I was on both the entrance, on both the merit lists, and the merit list for medicine and the interviews for medicine were before those for engineering. So my mom just said, why don't you just go take your seat, you know, the usual things that moms do. So I did that, and once I joined medicine, I said it's okay, I never really went for my engineering interviews, and that's how I landed up becoming a doctor. But I have never looked back, and today if you tell me that, you know, if you're back in the same position, what would you do? I have, without a doubt, I can say that I think it was the best decision that I took. It is one of the most satisfying professions I think anyone can have, despite all the rigors that we go through. I think on a very long journey, when we move from being students to being residents, and then over a period of time, when we are in our practice, we have different role models. But I think one person who has profoundly influenced me is Dr. Atul Shah. He was my guide when I did my MCH. And it's from him, I think, I imbibed my passion for working for the poor, for working for the downtrodden. While I did my residency, right at that time, I went and offered a lot of services to camps, and we used to go to very small places across the country, and I offered services, surgical services, to leprosy patients at that time. And that's when I realized that there's so many people in our country who need this service, where we need to go to them and they are not able to even go to the nearest town. Since then, to date, I continue to offer services which are voluntary, and I offer my surgical expertise to patients in smaller towns and villages where it's not easily available. So yeah, I think it's Dr. Atul Shah, my guide, who shaped these thoughts of mine. I think that doctors also face mental health challenges, which are similar to the rest of society. But there is one thing which I must say, that during the training period, our training needs a lot of discipline. And especially for the surgical branches, I think it's more like the army. There are times when you don't sleep, you don't eat, you choose between, am I going to have a bath or am I going to have breakfast? And you need to be running back to your patients. And in situations like that, when we were young, we never questioned it. But I think today's generation probably needs a little bit more balance in life. I don't know whether that is leading to more problems. But yes, I guess a person who is unable to lead a very disciplined life may have mental health challenges in this situation. Maybe they were not prepared for the kind of life that they would lead, where in the process of becoming a specialist and a super specialist, you have to leave your life behind. And at least in that age, when you are before 30, you have to be working without thinking about yourself at all. This is something which has had a very big impact in the overall healthcare system, because you start doing very defensive medicine when there is violence. Also, there are times, and I know of surgeons who have stopped offering adequate surgery, or they say that they will not do those kind of surgeries anymore because these are tough surgeries at times, that there are complications and we have to accept it. Finally, sometimes I feel that society seems to have forgotten that we are human, and that we have a certain definite, lifespan. And you cannot, the doctors, we are not gods. We are doing the best that we can. If society would at all times remember that we on our own do not want our patients to suffer, and that we ourselves want the best for our patients, then they would have more faith. It is this lack of faith that has led to defensive medicine, and on occasion maybe offering the lesser of, you know, what the best that you could have done. I think AI, artificial intelligence, is coming in very rapidly, especially in the medical fields. And if you see the, you know, for the physicians or maybe for the radiologists and pathology, there is going to be a lot of AI. Where surgeons are concerned, I think also there is so much of robotic surgery going on. So there is a big difference between earlier, and I think that these strides are only going to keep becoming bigger and bigger. I will never forget, that's true. So I was just in my second MBBS. We had just started our clinical post, and I was trailing the surgical department. It was probably 11:30, 12 at night. The emergency ward was very silent, and I was following the registrar. We were quite a few of us. And there on one of the beds in the emergency ward, I saw a child, probably a young boy, basically 8 to 10 years old. He was attached to a ventilator. He was not moving, and his father was sitting beside him. The registrar told us that they knew that the child would not really, survive. And I could see that father just sitting there with a bit of tears in his eyes. And he knew that, you know, the child would not live. I think that really impacted me at a very young age. I was just in my second MBBS, and I felt that whatever I do, I need to do something where it matters, where it's a life and death situation, where I can make a difference to the lives. And I have never forgotten that incident. It's like a stamp on my head, you know, that whole scene that I saw. I think I'm happy to say there were lots of success stories. According to me, most of our patients are success stories. It's only a few who are not success stories. But I can tell you the story of one lady. She had suffered burns, a high percentage of burns, but she had survived it. At the time of burns, she said that she had done it herself, but actually it had been inflicted on her by her husband. When she came to me, she had a very severe deformity where her chin was actually stuck to her chest, and she was in this position, which was pretty terrible. So I released her. She came back to function, but yet there was a lot more that I thought I could do for her in terms of improving her aesthetics. I think there's one thing I must tell you, that as plastic surgeons, we don't just make the normal more beautiful, but we also make the abnormal normal. So most of the work that we do is that you make the abnormal normal. So here I had this lady, I managed to bring her to function, but there was so much more I could do. And a whole 8 years later, when she had more confidence, she came back to me. I did a lot more surgery on her. I replaced a lot of her skin. And today I can say that she is doing very well in society. She has managed to adjust in society. She is now working as a caregiver for patients who are homebound. And I think that is one success story that I feel very proud about. I'm very proud of my patient herself, that as a burn survivor, she is now back in society and being very, she's giving a lot back to society. Staying fit is the most important thing. We cannot just say that, you know, you can take some time out to stay fit. And if we are going to give some holistic medicine to our patient, we need to be holistic also with our own self. So do fitness, whatever you like, but make sure that you are physically fit, you know, do yoga, do whatever exercises that you think you can do. And that is going to keep you healthy throughout life.